Welcome to an experience powered by Pipe TV.
Powered by Pipe TV. You are now watching Pipe TV.
Watching Pipe TV. I'm your host, Lil Nat, and we have a special guest from Jersey, hip-hop artist, film producer, radio host, writer. Please give it up to Dadah Terry, T-O-L-C, the building.
Yes, T-O-L-C, your boy Dadah Terry, still 90s. What's good?
What's good with you? By the way, Happy New Year. I hope everybody had a wonderful New Year. How was your New Year?
My New Year was fine. It was fine. Looking for big things this year.
Okay, so why are you called T-O-L-C? Well, and why we have to say it T-O-L-C? Like, everybody says it like that.
Because that's my tagline. You know, T-O-L-C came from my father. Hmm. My father had a shop called Top of the Line Detailing.
Oh,
and
okay.
And, you know, my name used to be The Crusher.
Okay. And why they called you The Crusher?
Well, that's what I had when I was a little kid. Well, you know, recipes to my man Earl, he gave me that name.
Okay.
And he taught me how to rap and everything. He said, your name gonna be The Crusher. So as, you know, he passed away, God rest his soul. But when, you know, as the years was going, back in like 2000, when I was dealing with Alicia Keys and them peoples, my name was The Crusher. And then when Bone Crusher came out, I had to change it, yes. So, you know, that's why I changed it to Top of the Line Crush.
Okay.
And then, as you know, as the years start progressing, I started, you know, getting my clothing going. So it's Top of the Line Clothing. And I started doing movies, Top of the Line Cinema.
So it all connects together, right.
So,
and Dadah Terry came from where?
Well, that's my name, Dadah Terry. I mean, that's my middle name. You know, mm-hmm. Your mother them call you growing up. And I just got used to it. I love everybody calling me Dadah. That's just, I'm used to that.
Okay. It's just like being Jamaican. In my house, everybody in my family have 50 million names, and no one call you what's on your birth certificate. Makes no sense. So let's talk about this Still 90s project.
Yeah.
Why you called it Still 90s?
Because you.
Me?
Yeah, yes. Yes, because of you. Because like I said, when you said to me, you know, with the demographics, you said, you reach between 35 and 45.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, when I thought about it, you know, you was right. And I do thank you because you motivated me, because every time people hear my song, they say, Dadah, you dope, but you take the essence, you know, you remind me like of that, bringing back the essence of hip hop flow. And it's not old school, and it's not new school, it's just, you know, mid-level, mid-range. And I'm like, okay, you try to keep up with what's going on mm-hmm. in today's rap, but they're like, you got your own lane. So I said, you know what? Let me go ahead and just, you know, not lie to myself and start rapping my age.
Mm-hmm.
And it worked because these songs, you know, were still 90s. Shout out to Dugard, I mean, for making me that powerful
the
track.
Beat miners?
Yes, the Beat Miners. And, you know.
What other producers you worked with?
Everybody. Shout out to my man Push Buttons.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out to Eli Alcatrax.
Okay.
You know, my man Zay from A Squad Rebel Radio. You know, The list goes on and on and on. My man Will Curry helped me out, AP. Steve Carlos from he used to work at Def Jam, now with Warner Brothers. He gave me the track with Rihanna.
Okay.
So it all worked out. And as I was working on the project, it was like a masterpiece. And it all worked with that boom bat.
And the 90s era is, you never can go wrong with the 90s hip hop, 90s R&B, 90s reggae. That era appeals to all ages, all genres. It's just something about that musical flow that keeps everybody happy and going. Yeah. And it's classics over and over and over. Not to take away from the 70s. The 70s had a good era too. But it's something about that 90s era. Even the younger generation can relate to that 90s
yes.
era. Yes. I don't know about their music today, but that's another topic for another guest. But yeah, but that 90s era is really, really cool. Any videos we can see for any singles you have on that project?
Oh, yeah. Shout out to my man Marksman. I paid him for like 4 videos already. I've been paying him videos as we're going, because a lot of artists got to understand, you know, you got to invest into your craft.
Mm-hmm.
So what I do is I pay people ahead of time, you know. So I was giving him money like, look, here go another video. Here go another video. When you get paid, take this $150. Take this $100. And then, you know, I accumulated. So now we're going to be start doing videos. I got Peep the Slang. That's going to be my first single.
Okay.
The one that I did with Rihanna, I shot that video because, of course, I was in the Bahamas.
Okay.
So I wound up, so since she's from the Caribbean and I went out to the Bahamas, I made that deal go down. So, you know, when the weather break, we're going to start seeing a lot of.
You had teased the audience with the single Night and Day.
Yes.
How's that going for you? It's still but generating a buzz?
You know, Night and Day, yes.
Is that I'll Be Sure.
Yes, Night and Day, I still perform that to this day because, you know, it's a classic.
Mm-hmm.
But then sometimes you have to keep that in your pocket and start working on other things, because people want to know who you are, want to know who am I, what else could you do?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're nice, you got a good flow, but what else could you do? What else kind of music that you can, I want to hear more.
Mm-hmm.
That was the thing, because sometimes when you get tired of a song and people loving it, it's like, okay, what else you got?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, I still got that in the pocket. I still perform that to this day.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to start branching off, to start doing other things and still keep that incorporated with my other songs.
Okay, so out of all the songs that you've written, recorded, produced it, which one is your favorite?
The one that's my favorite song, well, the song is called Did It On Them.
Okay.
Yeah, Did It On Them is definitely, you know,
who produced
the Brown
that
Sugar.
One?
No, that's Brown Sugar. That's a sample from Brown Sugar. Remember the movie Brown Sugar?
Mm-hmm.
And people are like, yo, I love that track, you know. So Brown Sugar, that right there, it was the set of that spark. That would be a spark. And the thing is, I ain't even put that out yet. Like,
mm-hmm.
I play it, but I ain't put it out. But when I re-put that out, it's gonna be definitely a good thing. But as far as my original.
Mm-hmm.
Music, I love the Peep the Slang.
Okay.
Yes.
And why?
Because that was the big L. You know, when my man Stress gave me the beat, shout out to Stress, he gave me the beat. I was sitting in his house, and I'm like, I'm listening.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I'm listening like for hours, falling asleep, you know what I'm saying,
mm-hmm.
listening to his beats, and that Peep the Slang came on. I said, yo, do me a favor. I said, I need you to put Nas and Big L and that, you know,
mm-hmm.
into the hook, because it's still 90s.
Right.
And I'm like, he said, I ain't want to do it. I said, bro, could you do me a favor and just put
and
it
just
in there?
Just put it in there.
And when he put that in there, and I said,
and
yo,
made the song
I'm going to be like Big L to pay homage for him on this track.
Okay.
So I just rapped just like how Big L would do to pay homage,
mm-hmm.
but I made it mine.
Right.
And then when people heard it, they was like, oh my God, this is a hot track. So I can't wait to release that on video.
Okay, so, excuse me. Let's go back to listening to beats. Do you have to write your lyrics or your songs listening to a beat, or do you have a song written out that you can create and then you find a beat for the song?
No.
How's your writing style?
My writing is, I write to every beat.
Okay.
And I'm not going to lie, shout out to AP, you know, that made me the Biggie Smalls track.
Mm-hmm.
I got that off of him, because, you know, when you write to a beat, you get the best of the, you know, the music.
Right.
Because you hear every sound, tone, you know when to say, you know what I'm saying? Hold up. You know when you stand in that pocket,
mm-hmm.
you know? So when you learn how to stand in that pocket, it's like, okay, every little tink, tone I listen to, I gravitate to. Like, oh, I'm going to say this on this tick right here with the beat. I'm going to say that on that tick. That's why people love, like, my delivery.
Okay.
Because I love writing to a beat.
Okay. Love now it. You have the Still 90s radio show. How did that come about?
Well, to promote my album.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the Still 90s radio show, I was talking, you know, getting interviewed over at A-Squad Rebel Radio. And shout out to my man Grumpy, the A-Squad Rebel Radio, Zed, everyone. I was on the phone with Grumpy, and I'm just happy to be talking to him.
Okay.
And we just talking about life.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, you know what? That's why I need a radio show, because I just need my word out there. And this was by mistake, just having a conversation. And he said, hold on for a second. Made one phone call. He said, hey, won't you come on and get your own radio show? I said, I ain't never did radio before. And that's when it came about. So I went up there. They interviewed me. It went fast. I reached out to you, and you know, you said, okay, I'll help you out when I can, and it just took off. Okay. I had no idea Still 90s was going to take off the way it did.
Nice.
Yes.
Any way that our audience can find your music to listen to it right now, or are you in the process?
I'm in the process.
Okay.
I'm in the process because now with music now, it's a little different with Spotify mm-hmm. and Apple Music. A lot of people really not, you know, buzzing on these streams. Gotta be a better way in the music business. But yeah, so I will be putting my stuff on the platform, mm-hmm. but I gotta figure this thing out.
Okay.
But I'm coming this year.
Okay. Let the audience know your social media if they wanna book you for shows or be a guest on your radio show.
Yes, if you wanna be a guest on my radio show, first you can find me at Facebook, that's Dadah Terry, DadahTerry. That's all Instagram, Twitter, TikTok. And also, Still 90s. You can reach out to me. All you gotta do, inbox me, hit me up, and you can find me. Still 90s Radio. Let's go. TOLC.
Nice.
Featuring Lil Nat. When she wanted to be Lil Nat on my show.
Yeah, when I have the time.
Yeah, when she
Anything
got the time.
Anything else you wanna share with the audience?
Just, you know, anybody that's trying to, you know, grind out, do their, you know, any hip-hop artists that's trying to get their music out, just, you know, start getting your ads, start, you know, investing into your craft, and, you know, start getting more and more advice from people that's in the industry, and don't afraid to ask, and always remember, you're only going to be successful if you can accept the word no.
And you have to have a tough skin. Speaking of accepting the word no, in this industry, it's not a lot of love in it.
No, it's not. A lot of snakes in the grass.
So if you really want to be in this industry, you really got to stay focused, dedicated, and just stay strong, because it's going to be the people like crab in the barrel going to pull you back. And if you really want to do it, you got to keep doing it. And remember, you might not make no money right away.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
You might not. So you might have to have that 9-to-5 or that part-time job. Just like dancers and actors that do waitressing and bartending, then they go on auditions. Same thing. It's no different. And don't believe the hype either, because what you see in musical videos and what you see on TikTok is not always what it appears to be.
No, it's not.
Not everybody in this business is billionaires and millionaires.
Yes.
And sometimes you don't even want that kind of trouble. Look at Diddy right now.
Oh, man. I got over.
You want that kind of trouble.
I got over 200,000 views already.
Just talking about that topic on your radio show.
Talking about the topic
on
my radio show. And I'm about to, you know, and the forms is going syndication, you know, and hopefully that works out. And yes. Also, before, you know, we end this, I met Jay-Z's best friend downstairs.
Who's that?
I got his business card.
Who's his best friend?
You want to pull out the business card? I'll pull out the business card.
Well, Jay-Z got a lot of friends that say they're his best friends. I got to see evidence.
Yeah,
we got to know so we can interview him the next time he in the building. He can't just be walking up here and not take a visit at Pipe TV. But we'll get that information another time.
His name is Stuart M. Gross.
Okay, we're going to do some research on that Stewart guy.
Yes. I gotta call him when I leave out of here.
If he works something, we'll bring him up here.
Yes, yes.
All right, thank you, Dada Terry TOLC, for coming here on Pipe TV. Appreciate you. Wish you the best of luck with your music and your radio show and whatever future endeavors you may have.
Thank you so much.
Okay, it's Lil Nat and it's Pipe TV.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's your boy Dada Terry. Shout out to Mr. Cox.
Welcome, 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 everyone. This is Pipe TV, and I'm your host, Lil Nat, and I have a guest here who is actually my son. That's a DJ. His name is DJ Rell.
Yep, yep, yep. I'm proud to be here. Appreciate to be here. Thank you.
College graduate, by the way. He's a DJ with a college degree. University.
There she go. Mom. Time to be mom, huh?
So, when you were growing up, I had you in every sport. Mm-hmm. You wanted to be a ball player. I wanted you to be a baseball player, but that's besides the point. You wanted to be basketball. You got to college. You decided that you wanted to do a radio show, and then you became this big DJ in Connecticut. What made you go and switch that career?
I'll say back in high school, like my senior year of high school, I tried out for my basketball team. And coach one point said, oh yeah, you made the team, you know, congratulations.
Right.
And then the next point, you know, I didn't make the team. So like growing up, basketball was like my very, very like, I'm gonna be an NBA star.
That
I'm gonna prove to
career.
The world. Yeah, I'm gonna prove to the world that sure guys could win,
mm-hmm.
you know? So that's why it was my dream. And then once I didn't make the team, I was like, wow. All right, but I could still walk on college, you know, it doesn't matter. And then once I get to college, now I tried out, and I saw that there's people who's taller than me,
way
faster
taller.
Than me, more athletic than me, and stuff like that. I was like, yeah, I can't. There's no chance for me here. Mm-hmm. It's like my basketball dream, it doesn't go to waste, but it's like my basketball dream, I knew it was like the chance of me making it where I want to make it. It's like, nah. So I realized like I'm in college, got nothing else fun to do. What can I do to like keep me entertained?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, DJ, and I could make money out of this too. So it's like, it's a win-win situation for me.
Mm-hmm.
And then as I kept on doing it, I just started getting the love of it. And then to a point like a year go by, 2 years go by, I realized like, I could actually do this for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I could be like the best at it.
Mm-hmm.
So let's just do it. That's how it is.
So when you was transitioning from realizing that basketball was not going to be it,
mm-hmm.
What made you stay strong and focus on something else? What motivated you to say, okay, I'm not going to allow this to pull me back and make me depressed and shut me down?
Life is too short to just feel like you be miserable or to just waste time.
Mm-hmm.
Feel me? If one thing that's not going right, all right. What's the next plan?
Mm-hmm.
You always got to have a plan B in life, or a plan C and a plan D. No matter how much plans you have, you always got to have a second plan to your main plan. Because sometimes it's not going to go the way that you want to go.
True.
You know, so.
That's true, because I was supposed to be a ballerina. Got a scholarship at New York University for mm-hmm. ballet, for dance. Did it a whole year. Had a scholarship for Alvin Ailey, Ballet Hispanico.
Fun fact, she's not going to tell you. She used to try that for the Next City Dancer, too.
Well, you had to tell him that. and then I sprained my ankle freshman year, and I did the same thing you did. Because my mother was like, you got to go to college. And I really didn't want to go to college because dancers are supposed to be dancing now. And then I said, you know what? I'm not going to waste all this money. I found the radio station at NYU 89.1 FM, very popular radio station. And I just changed my major from film, television, and radio, and that's how I got where I am. So you were in radio, you DJing, you doing all these parties. How did you get the gigs in Connecticut? Like, how did you get the parties?
Oh, man. Shout out to my longtime friend, Keisha.
Mm-hmm.
You feel me? She's the one person who started, like, telling people, oh, yeah, I know somebody who's a DJ.
Word of mouth.
So you word of mouth, basically. So, like, I would go to University of Hartford. So Connecticut is a small state. Mm-hmm. So like my school is right next to like 20 minutes away from like Trinity. Mm-hmm. And then we 45 minutes away from UConn. Mm-hmm. So every school is like close to each other. Mm-hmm. So once somebody knows about like, oh, there's a new DJ here, mm-hmm. you know, they could, they can book me, mm-hmm. you know, it's mad easy. And mm-hmm. it's like, it's a small area. Mm-hmm. So once, you know, she tell like one person like, oh, I know somebody who like a promoter, let me get you on. Mm-hmm. I was like, all right, cool. She told that promoter, yo, he's a DJ, da 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 da, mm-hmm. put him on. And then it's my second semester, freshman year, my spring semester, mm-hmm. first party I did, dude named Jesse Quest.
Okay.
He hit me up, he was like, yo, I heard you a DJ in Hartford, you know, from UHeart. You want to do a party? All right, cool, let's do it, da, 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 da. Set it up, and then that party from there, I just went out.
I saw your Instagram, your Facebook. Your parties were packed.
Yeah.
And crazy.
Man, yeah.
and a little crazy. Yeah. I had to not act like I was your mom while I was watching these videos and stuff. But you started doing some concerts as well.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get that work? Opening concerts, big concerts too. What are the concerts you opened? And then you tell me how you got started with that.
So
you opened for a lot of people.
I've done a lot of concerts. I did NLE Chopper, Griselda, Chief Keef. That's probably one of my favorite ones doing Chief Keef. There's so many, a lot. But how I got to that was seriously just hanging out with a lot of people. My man, DJ Trouble Kid, who was DJing Trinity. Mm-hmm. Like, all of us, it was like a small group. It was me, Trouble Kid, DJ Tay, Drewski. It was just like four of us. We was like brothers. We was a whole group. So we all networked down. I'm the youngest. Mm-hmm. So like they going like out of college. They was like, listen, when we gone,
you
the one who got to take over CT, like keep it alive. So I said, okay, it's no, you know, I'm not afraid of no challenges. So with Trouble Kid did the baby concert with Big Mike, mm-hmm. Big Mike the Ruler. And Big Mike, I would hang out with him. Big Mike was like, hey, like Trouble Kid was like, hey, here's Rell, da 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 da. And then from there, I just connected with Big Mike. And then
started doing a concert. So now that you're a DJ, your father's a DJ, Mr. Walt from the Beat Miners, your uncle's DJ Evil D, do you feel any type of pressure? Your mom was on a radio station, Hot 97.
Do I feel any pressure? Hell
no. No? Mm. Ooh, wait till I call your dad.
I don't feel pressure. I just know eyes is watching me.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I just know like, okay, he's Mr. Walt's son, he's Lil Nat's son. What he's gonna do, you
right.
know? And there's a lot of people, you know, there's a lot of people like legends, you know, they still look at me as like a little kid.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, when I tell them or when stuff tell them like, hey, I'm a DJ, they still gonna look at me as Little Wolf.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, once I plug in my laptop, oh, yeah, he a DJ.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I've been trying to tell you. But, you know, I don't have no pressure.
Okay, that's good. Because, you know, when I was working at High 97, it was and Kiss FM, Shayla had her son first. Anybody who knows Shayla, she used to do the overnights, and then she did the morning show, middays. Now she's on the block on the weekends.
Mm-hmm.
And then you were born. And then after you were born, Angie Martinez used to babysit you during her shift from Master Flex. I had to take him to work everywhere. And after you were born, Flex had his first daughter, Angie had her son, Enough had his son, and now Enough's son is doing production.
Right, shout out to my boy Ryan.
Yeah, he's producing big artists. You do some beats as well, right?
Yeah.
How's that going for you?
I mean, I can't say I lost the love of it. I kind of lost the feeling of it, but I'm trying to get back to it now, here and there, you know? It was something to do during quarantine, during COVID.
Okay. Okay.
So, you know, I like to learn new things while I'm at it.
Okay, okay. So what made you lose motivation in making beats? Because a good producer is also an excellent DJ, because you already know what your crowd wants to hear, and you already ahead of the game
right.
when it comes to making that hit.
I'll say
Because producers and DJs control the mood and the crowd of people.
I did it to myself. I didn't put myself more out there as like, hey, I made beats. Mm-hmm. Let me send you some. Mm-hmm. So like, after I did work with some people and then I realized I wasn't getting that much work, it's like, okay, what's the point?
Right.
You know? And I love to like make beats, but it's like, mm-hmm. I don't have no love for it no more. But I'm slowly getting into it.
Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a different type of passion. You know, you have to be creative. I mean, I respect that type of art and that type of skill and DJing as well, because some people don't understand the artisticness of being a DJ.
Oh, no.
Even the customer want to not pay you. I got $200, but I got to bring my own equipment and stand for 6 hours.
That's for real.
Make that make
you
sense.
You know, sometimes you pay for your price, you know? If you want to get a DJ that paid $200, you gotta expect
a $200. You gonna get that push button DJ.
Yeah, you
right?
gotta expect a $200 worth of DJ. You know, sometimes it's like just like a doctor. You know, this you gotta put more money in order to get the best responses. You know,
mm-hmm.
And some people take this as a like they love it.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't not. You know?
You gotta respect their job, exactly. And if you want a nice party, you need a good DJ.
You gotta respect us.
So when you started learning how to DJ, you started on what?
Vinyl.
Mm-hmm.
Vinyl techniques. And then my grandma bought me my first Mac, my first DJ. The Mac with it. That's when I started using Serato and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. What you like better, digital or analog?
My young self want to say digital, because I don't have to bring no case, no crate, no nothing. I could just bring my laptop and I'm fine. But my old music loving self want to say a vinyl record analog, because the history behind it. Sometimes when you go to the party or sometimes when you listen to me, you like to hear the needle scratch.
Or that little crackly
noise. And stuff like that, because it's real life. It's, original. It's mm-hmm. original copy, you know? Mm-hmm. And sometimes the digital can be messing up or your computer can be messed up.
Your computer freezes? Everybody looking at you like...
That happened to me so many times.
Oh, my God. That is the worst feeling.
I'll take 10 seconds skip than like a whole party not playing. So I'll take that.
All right. If anybody want to book you, give them your social media.
If you guys want to book me, don't be afraid to hit me up. I'm not a mean guy, but... My Instagram is DJ_Rell_. That's DJ_Rell_.
And he plays everything.
Everything.
Spanish, Haitian, reggae, soca, calypso, anything. He plays it all.
Yep. Everything open format. You know, just shoot me a DM. My email is DJ.Rell7599@gmail if you want to get booking.
And yesterday's price ain't today's price.
Exactly, yep.
Shout out to
Fat Joe.
Fat Joe, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Anything else you want to say to the audience, your people?
If somebody tells you no, ignore them. If somebody say you can't do it, you feel like you can do it, do it. You know, there's a lot of people in this life that's going to tell you no. Ignore them, you know? It's your life. Live how you want to live your life, and that's it. You feel me? The only person that can make your life miserable is yourself. Don't let nobody else ruin your life.
Okay. All right, everyone. DJ Rell. I'm your host, Lil Nat, and it's Pipe TV.